just the opposite of St. John's wort are a wide variety of other botanicals, one of which is Goldenseal. And Goldenseal is marketed oftentimes with echinacea, which is still one of the most popular supplements in the United States. But Goldenseal is oftentimes used to prevent colds and upper respiratory tract infections. But a lot of folks like to use Goldenseal to try to mask the results of their urine drug screen. And depending upon which literature you look at, sometimes Goldenseal is quite effective. But as we're going to see, it can also render some medications much easier to detect. All right. So if you're a drug abuser, you damn well better know how your drug of abuse is being metabolized if you want to use Goldenseal to mask a drug screen, because you might get caught much easier. All right. But anyway, but it does have a pretty significant interaction risk, because unlike St. John's wort, it inhibits the metabolism of a lot of medications. And so here again, some of our studies that we did several years ago looking at the effects of Goldenseal on two important enzymes, 3A4 and 2D6. Again, you can see the reduction in the activity of 3A4 as well as 2D6 by about 40%, which is a pretty substantial amount. And again, these two enzymes are responsible for the metabolism of about 75% of all medications. So if you affect 3A4 and 2D6, it can be pretty significant. And there are two unique compounds found in Goldenseal that appear to be the culprits. They're isoquinoline alkaloids known as berberine and hydrastine. And the really interesting thing about berberine and hydrastine is that when they're metabolized by 3A4 and 2D6, the metabolite forms a covalent bond to the heme portion of the enzyme and just shuts the enzyme down. It's oftentimes referred to as a mechanism-based inhibitor or sometimes a suicide inhibitor. But these are very potent inhibitors of those enzymes. These are the structures of hydrastine and berberine, and the little broken circle here illustrates one particular functional group of the molecules called a methylenedioxyphenyl group. And these methylenedioxyphenyl groups are found in a wide variety of phytochemicals throughout the plant kingdom. And the reason for that is that these methylenedioxyphenyl-containing phytochemicals are oftentimes good insecticides. All right, because plants can't run away when the bugs start chewing on them, so they just make a lot of interesting chemicals to get rid of them. And so it just so happens that hydrastine and berberine are two of them. Now, what wasn't explained to you guys is I'm also an avid Civil War historian. And Civil War medicine is an interest of mine. And so I was at a conference one time, the Society of Civil War Surgeons. Yeah, there's actually a group like that. And, you know, odd guys like me go to those things. Anyway, so the guy who was talking about quinine substitutes in the Confederate Army during the Civil War. And you would think, well, why would anybody care about quinine substitutes? Well, when the Federal Navy blockaded all the major southern ports at the beginning of the war, it halted the import of quinine from South America. And in the mid-19th century, quinine was the drug, you know. And so it was probably more important than Viagra at that time. But anyway, because it was one of the few drugs that would actually lower fevers associated with malaria. Malaria was a big deal at that point. And so the Confederate Medical Department couldn't get quinine, and it was a major deal. And so the Surgeon General for the Confederate Army literally put out an edict for all the surgeons in the field to utilize natural resources, botanicals that were indigenous to the South, to try to find a substitute for quinine. Well, in their search for quinine substitutes, they didn't really find a good substitute. They didn't find a substitute at all right? But what they did find was that on occasion, if you actually used Goldenseal in conjunction with quinine, you didn't have to use as much of the quinine that you had, and the effects lasted longer. Well, when he said they were mixing Goldenseal and quinine, well, my hand goes up, oh, I know the mechanism of action for that. And they're all looking at me like, what, are you some kind of nut? What's the deal with you? And but what the deal is that quinine is a 3A4 substrate. And so that's one of the reasons why. So I thought that was really cool. Anyway, so now there are a whole host of other these methylenedioxyphenyl-containing compounds in the natural world. And one we're probably real familiar with, and that's piperine nigrum, or black pepper. And the piperamides that are present in black pepper, is quite a few of them, but the most important one, at least the most prevalent one, is piperine, or piperine, depending on how you want to pronounce it. But you can see it has one of these methylenedioxyphenyl groups. And not too surprisingly, it can certainly affect the CYP3A4 and affect the pharmacokinetics of drugs that are substrates for that enzyme. And this is looking at the effects of piperine nigrum on the anti-HIV med, nevirapine. Nevirapine has a pretty narrow therapeutic window, too. And so this is the nevirapine by itself in these open circles, and this is nevirapine plus piperine or black pepper extract. And so tremendous increase in the area under the curve, all right? And so it's clearly that can cause some significant herb-drug interactions. Now, there's another popular botanical extract that's being utilized in a wide variety of ephedra-free supplements, and that's schisandra extract. And Schizandra chinensis is indigenous to China. But there's a lot of unique, a lot of these interesting methylenedioxyphenyl-containing compounds in schisandra. The gomycins and schizandrin and schizanthrin and schizandrol, you know, and as you might expect, they can certainly inhibit the metabolism of a lot of medications, one of which is tacrolimus. And tacrolimus is pretty much taking the place of cyclosporin as an immunosuppressant, but it's also a substrate for 3A4 and P-glycoprotein like cyclosporin. And so when you take schizandra in conjunction with tacrolimus, this is the area under the curve for tacrolimus by itself. This is area under the curve with tacrolimus with schizandrin. So again, tremendous increase in the area under the curve. And so these are clinically relevant herb-drug interactions that can occur with these methylene dioxyphenyl groups. Now, the latest example of a clinically relevant pharmacokinetic herb-drug interaction comes to us from an article that's scheduled for publication in a few weeks. And it describes the effect of green tea on the beta blocker nadolol. And so what you can see here is that green tea, this is nadolol with water, nadolol with green tea. A tremendous reduction in the area under the curve for nadolol when it's taken with green tea. Again, 700 milliliters of green tea per day. Not only reduces the absorption, but also reduces the excretion of unchanged nadolol. And together, green tea appears to dramatically reduce the antihypertensive effect of nadolol. And the reason for that is that nadolol is a substrate for one of these uptake transporters. And it looks like the green tea catechins, which are the catechins are fairly ubiquitous in a wide variety of plants, but particularly in green tea. And it looks like the catechins not only inhibit this uptake transporter 1A2, OATP1A2 in vitro, but it's one of those rare instances where it translates into the in vivo condition as well. But what's really interesting is that green tea is one of the world's most popular drinks. And it's also almost ubiquitous in most ephedra-free supplements today. So there's certainly a substantial likelihood of this green tea and at least substrates for OATP1, 1A2 being affected by green tea.